BBC World Service for Africa. African Perspective. Presented this week by Neville Harms. In the coming months in Uganda, a general election is due to be held, and the parties are already preparing themselves for the contest. After the last one in 1980, following Amin's overthrow, President Milton Obote and his United People's Congress Party, the UPC, were declared the winners. But there was much controversy about the result at the time, and a great deal of turmoil and bloodshed has stemmed from it. Yoweri Museveni, for instance, defeated in the election, declared it a fraud and took to the bush to wage a guerrilla war against the government, mainly in the Luwero district northwest of Kampala. The president's handling of that conflict is just one of the issues that Uganda's voters will be considering when they give their verdict on the government's record over the last four difficult years. Well, Robin White of our program Focus on Africa has been in Kampala, and for this edition of African Perspective, he talked at some length to President Obote.
Dr. Obote, you returned home in triumph after many years in exile, and you became president once again, but there has not been entirely peace in this country. Now, has your past 4 years been a happy time, or has it been a great disappointment to you?
There's no disappointment at all in Uganda. The majority of the people of Uganda will say the same. The last 4 years have brought a change, a tremendous change for the better. The economy is progressing, the politics of Uganda are stabilizing, transport is there, trade is progressing, people are moving freely. There is no disappointment whatsoever in Uganda.
I was thinking of yourself personally, whether it had been a
happy
time. Why
should I be disappointed when my people are not disappointed?
One problem that you have had, sir, is the problem of dissidents continuing to fight in the Luwero Triangle. Now, how soon do you think this problem might come to an end?
I can't give any definite date of how soon the problem may come to an end, but the fact is that there has been no expansion of dissident areas at all. If anything, their numbers and the areas are shrinking.
Are you determined to win a military victory there?
I'm not determined to win any form of victory in that sense of your questioning. I want to stabilize Uganda. The whole purpose of the elections in 1980, the platform on which my party was elected, was to bring peace to the people of Uganda. And these are criminals, and we have got to deal with the criminals within the laws of Uganda.
It has been suggested, sir, as I'm sure you're aware, that you should sit round a table with Yoweri Museveni and sort this matter out.
This is not a personal matter between me and anybody. This is a constitutional matter. We have had an election, we have got a parliament, we have got constitution, we have got the laws of Uganda, we have got high courts. If there are differences, political differences, let them be settled politically. And the one way of settling political differences is elections. Another way is to go to the courts. And I'm not going to deceive the people of Uganda that someone who loses an election should be accommodated in any administration after he has gone to the bush and shot a few buses and ambulances and killed some people, nurses, teachers, students, and then we bring him back to government, in which case you forget about the constitutional means of governance, because somebody else is going to repeat the same kind of thing, then you are going to have another meeting, then a third person will do it, you are going to have another meeting, a fourth person will do it, you are going to have another meeting. I have rejected that type of suggestion, and I'm correct there. And I'm sure the people of Uganda will support that line in the next elections.
Is that what you think Mr. Museveni wants? You think he wants a job in this government?
It is not me who brought that question, it is you. It is you who brought that question, that why should I talk to Museveni? I said it's not a personal matter, as far as I'm concerned.
But what do you think Yoweri Museveni wants through fighting? What is he after?
I don't know. If I knew, I would be very happy, because I really don't know. Museveni was a member of the military commission. He was number two in the military commission. He and the rest of the members of the military commission organized elections. And soon after elections, he decided to fight. And he hasn't progressed very much in his own area where he was born. He's not effective, he's not known, and he's a refugee himself in another part of Uganda. So I really don't know what he wants.
Whatever the wrongs of his case, wouldn't it save a lot of life and a lot of money to talk to him?
I told you it is not a personal matter. Why do you think Museveni is all that important in this country? First of all, he's not a citizen. He's not a citizen.
Where is he?
He lost an election. He has no party which is viable in this country. Because he's a gunman. Your name is Robin. Do you remember the history of England called Robin Hood?
I do.
Yes? Is it worthwhile talking to Robin Hoods of this world? Baden-Meinheim in Germany? The Irish Republic Army people? Is it worthwhile talking to such gangsters and terrorists?
You say he's not a citizen. What do you mean by that?
Because his father was not born in Uganda. And that is the constitutional basis. So he cannot be a citizen.
The strongest advocate for talks is not coming from opposition politicians. It's coming from the Archbishop.
I have answered that question. I'm not going to ask anymore. I have said I do not accept any proposal about talks. And I'm going to make this an election issue. You wait for the votes.
Do you think the forthcoming elections could in any way lead to a way out of this impasse?
What impasse? There's no impasse. The mess of the country is very peaceful. Even Luero is very peaceful. We have administration in Luero.
But do you think after the elections that the trouble might end some way?
Please, I've told you I'm not answering anymore. If you came here to talk about the dissidents, Babu 7, let us stop this interview.
If I could turn to the elections.
Why don't you talk about the whole western region, which is peaceful, much of Buganda, which is peaceful, the whole eastern region, the whole northern region? Why do you talk about a handful of gunmen? And you take my time, 30 minutes, 1 hour, to talk about a handful of gunmen? You came all the way from London for this purpose? No wonder members of parliament in Britain sometimes talk about starving the BBC from funds, because you waste public funds in this type of way.
If I could turn to the elections, how do you see the next elections going?
It's going to be conducted in the normal way.
Do you think you're going to win these elections?
I think so. I can't see another party that can win this election. Our record is there. We have done some work that in 1980 people didn't know which direction Uganda would go. Everything was declining. Not today. So that with that kind of record, I can't see another party really giving us a terrible challenge.
Will you stand on your economic record, will you?
Every record, political, economic, and otherwise.
If I could talk about the economy, which things have gone well and which things have gone badly?
We started from almost position zero. Everything has started moving upwards. Obviously, they cannot all move at the same speed.
Would you accept that in the industrial sector it has been slow progress?
What could we have done in the industrial sector? We had no skilled manpower. We had machinery which had not been looked after for years. We had no raw materials. So industrial sector could not have progress at the same speed as the agricultural sector.
What are your biggest economic priorities at the moment?
Production. Production, we are asking the people of Uganda to produce and produce anything that can be consumed in Uganda and anything that can be sold abroad.
How pleasing has the agricultural sector been to you?
You would have been very happy if you are a member of Uganda People's Congress or a member of this government by two factors. One, we have food in Uganda. When I came to office, there was no food in Uganda. Now we are feeding ourselves and we are exporting some of our food. 2, our export earnings are increasing. Now, these are most pleasing developments.
There have, I'm sure you're also aware, been criticisms of your human rights record in this country, particularly from the United States of America. Now, how upset have you been by the accusations?
I have not been upset in the way you probably think I should have been. I've been upset in the sense that if you refer to the statement made by one American official in August of last year, in that he made a generalized statement but could not give us evidence to prove that the facts of that statement. If you go to Luero, you will not find any single possibility that a government such as mine could have murdered about 250,000 people within a few months, and yet no graves and no statement from the general public. So that one was very hurtful. But as I say, we are not trying to run this government for the pleasure of people abroad. We are trying to run this government for the good of the people of Uganda. And these are our people. These are our people. When people talk about human rights in Uganda, they don't seem to understand what they're talking about. I inherited a very difficult situation in 1980. I found 7,000 men in jails, former main soldiers and other characters. I have released all of them, except about 35, all of them. We have settled them in the countryside. We inherited a police force of 3,000 only. When in 1971, when Amin took over the government, we had 20,000 police officers and men in the force. But this 3,000 was not trained, it had no equipment, it was demoralized. We had no army to speak of. Uganda army was too young. It had been recruited on a factional basis. Half of it, that force deserted in December and January, December 1980, January 1981. So that was the enormity of the problem. Now, we have stabilized the conditions. You do not now hear gunshots in Kampala. You do not hear people talking about lawlessness of soldiers or anybody. So people, they are dreaming.
It's not just the outside world that has expressed concern. I mean, some lawyers in this country have expressed concern about what they describe as violations of human rights, like people being detained, like people being released by the courts and then rearrested.
Very well, very well. You see some lawyers in this country, you go and ask them if their counterparts in other parts of Africa are as free as themselves here. Go and ask them whether they were free at all in the 1970s to go to court, to take government to court, to plead different cases, to talk about detention. Go and ask them whether in other parts of Africa there is no detention and how many of their colleagues in other parts of Africa have been so open as to speak about their respective governments. These things are in comparison. If you see detention is a sign of a violation of human rights, then you may have well condemned virtually all African states.
But doesn't it make a mockery of justice if people are released by the courts and then rearrested outside?
Well, does that happen only here?
No.
There you are. Then go and ask everybody else.
Perhaps people have higher standards in this country.
What people have higher standards?
Well, people have greater expectations of justice.
Yes, and they should have it. They're going to have it. But something has to start from a base. Our courts were not functioning 5 years ago. They're just beginning to function now.
Did the accusations that were made by this one American official you were talking about, have those allegations caused a good deal of friction between yourself and the United States?
No. We sat down with the